All right, hi everyone. I'm going to talk about the work of a subgroup of the property graph schema working group of the LDC. And this is work that we did on sort of a community design around keys for property graphs. And this in the end was presented at SIGMOD 2021. So, so just to say that I'm actually just a spokesperson for a very a large team. It's actually a very nice collaborative effort covering essentially all parts of the property graph schema working group community. Nice balance of folks from academia and industry. And also as part folks in the ISO efforts. Okay, so why actually start here, right? So that our larger remit was to look at schema languages and schema constructs for property graphs. Well, this just seemed kind of a very natural kind of initial piece of the puzzle to tackle first. Right? It's self-contained in a way. And in general, why keys, right? Well, as we all know, keys are kind of key in data management, right? For identifying, referencing, constraining objects, for example, for data quality. So thinking in the context of property graphs, if we have, say, people nodes, they can be uniquely identified by, say, a login ID. They can be referenced, right? So identified by one of their email addresses. And we might also perhaps say that it's mandatory that each person has at least one email, and of which at most one can be, say, a preferred email. And we also might have that a person has zero or more aliases, which are exclusive to them, right? So no two people can share an alias. So there's a kind of different sorts of aspects that arise when you start reasoning about identity of objects. We also can go further beyond, say, just looking at the local properties of a person node and say, so for example, a discussion forum node is identified by its name, so this local property information, and also the identity of the person who moderates the forum, right? So the person who's on the other end of a has moderator edge. Right? So it's not just local information necessarily that's sufficient to identify or to reason about the identity of things. So keys are vital for managing identity, data integrity, right? So for example, thinking about an integrated knowledge graph, modeling key constraints that arise from the underlying data sources and say in maintaining data quality consistency in the graph itself as it evolves. Okay, so why now? Why are we looking at this? Well, as Alistair's presentation kind of highlighted and underscored, schema is important, and it's important now, right? So for us, so because property graph technologies are in the process of being standardized, and in this community, the property graphs and working group, we would like to work towards a consensus recommendation to inform this broader process, right? And also, furthermore, people are actually implementing key-like notions in diverse ways already in their products. And indeed, if you look, so this might be a little bit of out of date because we did this in prep for the SIGMOD 2021 paper, but at that time, the landscape was diverse. We found that some systems offer just a property-based primary keys just for nodes, so not edges. Some systems supported reasoning about uniqueness, some supported about reasoning about mandatoriness. And yet we need all of these and more, right, to be able to satisfy current practical needs. And so because of this significant drift between the database vendors, it is clear that we need to get on the same page. And there's decades and decades of work in the academic literature, reasoning about keys and constraints. And so we should bring the best of this to the needs of the industry partners. Okay, so I'll just distill down the essence of PG keys into our design requirements and using a couple of examples to highlight how we went about developing a solution satisfying these design requirements. So PG keys, essentially, if you see the box at the bottom left, that's the template for specifying keys. Our design requirements were to have the flexible ability to choose the scope of a key. So this is the red stuff. So where for some thing X, here it's a node, within this pattern. And so here you plug in your favorite pattern matching language. So we're kind of agnostic about that. A flexible choice of a way of describing the key values. So this is the green stuff. Right? So the here we're using the y and z, the values of y and z in this green pattern to identify the objects x identified in the red pattern. And again, this is a pattern in your favorite query language, probably GQL. Second design requirement was to go beyond just being able to specify keys for nodes, but also at the very least be able to specify keys for edges and also keys for properties. And we'd also like our formalism and our solution to be able to support identifying, referencing, and constraining objects. And finally, it should be practical to validate these constraints. Okay, let's take each of these in turn and I'll show how we went about satisfying these design requirements. So the first on flexible choice of scope and key values. So we declaratively specify the scope of the key and its values in your favorite part of our query language, right? So this is a parameter. This is kind of a meta, let's say, template for instantiating, specifying concrete key constraints. Here we're just going to use cyclex and x that we're all familiar with. So for instance, suppose we want to say that each person, right? So each P, node P, labeled person, each of these objects is identified by the value of the login property. Right? So in PG keys, we would specify that as that first pattern there. So for P within that pattern, it just selects nodes labeled person. These objects, this P is identified by the value of its login property. As another example, suppose we want to be able to specify that each forum, so four are here represented as nodes, having a member is identified by the name of the forum and its moderator. Right, so in PG keys, this would be so for those F within this pattern, and this is just F binds to a node labeled forum as an incoming edge labeled join from a node labeled person. For each of these F, they will be identified by their name, right? So their name property, and the identity of the person at the other end of a moderates edge coming into F. Okay, so that's the first part. It's very flexible. It's an arbitrary graph pattern there in your local graph pattern matching query language. Next, we're able to specify keys not just only on nodes, but also on edges and properties. Right, so the scope query selects the nodes, edges, or properties to be identified. So for example, we saw already an example of people being identified by their login. Right, so for those P within that pattern consisting of a single node, for each of those bindings, P, they are identified by their login value. And as an example of the key specified on edge objects, suppose we want to say that each edge labeled joined is identified by its endpoints, right? So there's no other joined, there's no other joined edge has the same endpoints, right? So we can't join the same form twice. This is specified in PG keys as for those E within the pattern. So E is bound to edges labeled joined from nodes labeled person to nodes labeled forum. For each of these E, they are identified by the bindings for P and F within this second pattern. So P is a node labeled person, F is a node labeled forum, and that E edge is the edge between that person and that forum. Okay, and then, so we've been using so far this keyword identifier, but actually able to support all the kind of basic use cases that we had around reasoning about keyness. We actually have a variety of keywords. So identifier is essentially the strongest form. So we'd like to be able to not only identify, but also reference and or constrain objects. So here identifier means that this is exclusive. So this is the example of those fora having at least one member. They're identified by their name and the identity of the person moderating the forum. This means that this is exclusive, so no objects in the scope share key values. It's exclusive. This is the basic requirement for keyness. Furthermore, this is mandatory, so each object in the scope has at least one key value, so you have to participate in this moderates pattern. And finally, this is a singleton, so each object in the scope has at most one key value. So you can look at combinations of, say, exclusive or having just an exclusive constraint or an exclusive mandatory or an exclusive singleton or all three. And then for that, we just have this identifier. Right, so if we look at the analog in SQL, so exclusive would be, say, a uniqueness constraint. Mandatoriness would be a particular attribute not being not null. And singleton just comes along with the data model. And just as in SQL property graphs, all three of these are needed. And needed in a much more sophisticated and complex way. Right? Because these values might not be sitting directly on the object itself, but they might be somewhere else on around the graph identified by the pattern matching. So referencing here is provided by the combination of exclusive and mandatory, right? So we might have, for example, that emails are not shared and each person has an email, right? So every person P, it must be the case that there's an edge labeled has coming out of P to a node labeled email, a node E labeled email, and that is exclusive, that object E is exclusive to P. And constraining can be done in many ways. For example, we might say that aliases are exclusive to people, but they don't necessarily have to have them, and they can have multiple aliases, so desire. Or we might have that people, they don't have to have a preferred email, but if they do, it's exclusive to them, and they can have only one. All right, and then finally, the final kind of design requirement was ease of validation. So in order to check that the PG key holds, you just use the underlying query engine, right? So you just run queries in the local language to find violations. So for example, this exclusive mandatory constraint on people nodes, right? So that it must be the case that every person has an email, at least one, and they're exclusive to the person. This will hold if both of the following queries return nothing. Right? So the first checks that there are no two people that have the same email. Right? That's the exclusiveness part. And it's not the case that there's a person that doesn't have an email. Right? So that's that would check for violations of the mandatory part. We discussed briefly in the team, but we left for future design study incremental validation, say batching. For PGPs. Okay, so that in a nutshell is our proposal. I don't know how we're doing on time.
You're on time.
Okay, okay. We also looked ahead a little bit in different ways that you might naturally extend the PGPs. So we had quite some in-depth discussion on how PGPs interact with nulls, right? So if the data can have null values, then we need to know that when we check in scoping, say finding people having a particular age, right, we can have, for example, that ages can be null. We have to have some way of reasoning about this and enforcing the key. So our approach is to design the PGP such that you can validate a given key K by executing a query that finds violations of K. So we thought everything through again, through the definitions and to see to which extent the scope can be reached. And essentially what we have to do is enforce that, we have to have that for this to make sense, that p.h is not null. And then we can validate this with an appropriate query. There are more details in our Sigma paper. Similarly, we thought also about bindings to paths, right? Because, say, for example, coming out of the G-core work, which is kind of a nice requirement for graph querying. So we also looked at regular path queries, adding regular path queries to these conjunctive queries that are scoping and extracting values. I suppose that if posts and forms can reply to other posts, then the following PG key, right? So for those X, which are bound to post nodes, we have that P in the path P specified by this actually RPQ, right? So from X, you get to following zero or more reply to edges, a node from which you can reach a form on an OP labeled edge. These paths identify X. This means essentially that each post is identified by its reply to path. in the forum where it was posted. And then finally, we also looked at what happens if you have complex values sitting in the properties, right? So our data model, we thought through allowing complex values such as tuples, sets, lists, and little JSON structures. And so in order to use these in PG keys, we just leveraged the functionality of the underlying query language that you instantiate PG keys with, right? So here, for example, if we have some complex data sitting underneath phone number properties of people, and we can access, let's say, an attribute, phone number, category, and from that we select the number. We have this as exclusive and mandatory to the person P. This is just saying that each person has an official telephone number and no two people can have the same official telephone. Okay, so this is just leveraging the query language. Okay, so looking ahead, well, PG keys, as we see, is not currently in being taken up into the first version of GQL. But it's really a call to action to industry and academia to guide the design and thinking and engineering of commercial and also academic graph systems and solutions. There are lots of interesting research problems that follow all of this work. So for example, validation and maintenance complexity for specific concrete languages that you use to realize PG keys. Basic questions such as implication and inference, reasoning about those problems for PG keys. Static analysis in the presence of PG keys for query optimization, richer property graph constraint languages beyond keys, and much more. And the schema working group is just getting started. Right? We're continuing the work of designing schema and constraint languages. And also looking at extensions to the property graph model driven by practical applications. So for example, properties and non-properties. There's lots of interesting work. Okay, thanks.
Okay, let's see whether we have any questions online. Yes, Martin.
Hey, thanks. Hey, thanks, very interesting. The basics, like let's say primary keys directly on nodes and all that, they seem fairly easy to implement for existing graph vendors maybe, but then the more complex part where let's say you have like a path that identifies something, that gets a whole different level of complexity, of course, right? And so most graph vendors, they don't really have like technology to like maintain or incrementally check these kind of constraints while the graph is changing. So that seems like an kind of a battle to get that in any system, right? So I'm wondering what have you heard so far? Is that about the enthusiasm of those part of the proposals and whether people would ever plan to implement something like that? I'm just curious what the general vibe of the more complex parts is. Yeah.
So one thing I really valued in this collaboration was the nice input from the industry partners in this work. So we kind of pared it down to kind of minimal sort of requirements and needs. And so this is a reflection of discussion with folks with real use cases for this functionality. In terms of actual experiences and implementation, I don't know of any work done in that space. Does anyone know about anyone going beyond or being influenced by the additional expressivity of?
So
Ming-Chi here. You want to come to the computer? I think this is what Mark. Part of what Martin is asking.
Yeah, so Tegograph actually recently looked at this paper, and since we have a strong type the schema, property graph schema in the industry, so we start looking at multi-edge and adding keys into our DDL. And we look at this and we found it's too expressive. In the sense, it's allow you add arbitrary unique constraint on a subgraph, especially for the pattern match part. But we for our needs, we just need a simple type level unique key. And initially, we have the node type primary key built in into the design. And for the edge, we use the edge type. We use the source and target vertex ID as the key. Now, when we add a multi-edge, then we just need a discriminator. So our key in the edge in our DDL is just a source vertex type, target vertex type, the edge type, plus a discriminator. So the intuition is if you have a person connect with another person, you may have different edge type, for example, person knows person and person work for a person, and they can have different discriminator to discriminate within an edge type. Across edge type, they can be the same discriminator value. So that's what we found practical for us. And we do see some needs for using constraint. And I think I didn't see that in the literature. So for example, cardinality constraint, a person can at one time work for one company. And if I have this cardinality constraint, then we can use that constraint to as an input to help us to optimize our prep plan. Such kind of thing, we haven't seen that. The cardinality constraint is really useful for optimization. And the key constraints, this one is really expressive and it's very powerful. We haven't had imperative needs for implementing them yet. Yeah, but we borrow a lot of idea and framework from this paper. Yeah, thank you.
Are there any other folks that have experience or have been influenced in some way? Or in the audience online?